this away.
In this episode, we talk about drugs and addiction. If you or anyone you know is struggling with addiction, please call the Alcohol Drug Information Service on 1800 250 015 or Narcotics Anonymous Australia on 1300 652 820. Both these hotlines provide confidential support 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
All right, episode 3. Why Do I Feel This Way with Kate DeRouge? I am Claudia, the random voice you're hearing, a friend of yours, Kate, and just here to help you tell your story. Now, the first two episodes, we spoke about Oz Idol.
Yep.
We spoke about your upbringing. We spoke about kind of being thrust into the media spotlight, young divas. And then we left off where you'd been in a relationship. You just started taking a stronger substance than cocaine.
Different substance. Just the next step, I guess, in my using. Yeah.
And your parents had kind of collected you from Sydney and brought you back to your hometown of Bendigo.
Yeah, look, it was time. What I was doing in Sydney wasn't working, and as we spoke about, like, despite everybody's best efforts, I just wasn't able to stop, and I was just in this never-ending cycle of going to bed, sure, and swearing that tomorrow was going to be different, and waking up and just doing the same thing. And it was, you know, what's the definition of insanity? You know, waking up every day doing the same thing and expecting a different outcome, and that's what I was doing.
Mm.
Yep.
Okay, so talk to me. You've just been literally picked up from Sydney. You're back in Bendigo. What's that first couple of weeks like being back in your hometown?
I don't really remember. I don't remember. I mean, obviously I was pretty sad, and it was admitting defeat, but I think there was still a deluded part of me that really thought I was going to get better. Like, I was just here to get better and then I could go back. Mm. You know, and that it was all going to be okay, and this was just a moment in time.
Were you singing still at this point? Is there any kind of music around you, or still involved in the industry?
Look, by the time I got back here, I'd mucked up every opportunity or second chance that I'd had in Sydney, and there wasn't a lot of faith in me by this point, you know what I mean? I'd managed to rally at some point and write some really great music and record some original material while I was in Sydney. But by the time I got back here, I was very overweight. My binging had really taken over. And yeah, there wasn't a lot of hope, I guess, or confidence in me to be doing a lot of professional stuff. So I think initially when I came back to Bendigo, it was more about, let's take it back to basics. Mm-hmm. And let's just try and get a bit of normality in our lives. Let's just start with not getting up every day and using whatever drug that I could get my hands on. And so I came back home and moved in with my folks. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And what was that transition like of getting off the nitrous, being in a country town? Would you call Bendigo a country town?
Yeah, I mean, certainly compared to Sydney, yeah.
Was it helpful not to have that kind of drug scene around here?
I mean, helpful in the sense of, it wasn't as easy for me to just go out and wake up in the morning and get what I wanted, but it would be really nice if you just did a geographical and all the problems disappeared. Mm. You know, it would be nice if you could just go in the other room and you left all your issues, you know, where they were. But, you know, as they say, wherever I go, there I am. And I just, all the thoughts and all the that pain and anxiety and fear and all of that stuff that I'd really spent some time dedicated to avoiding was still there. Mm. And not only was it there like it was before, I'd now added to it. You know what I mean? Like, I'd had to come to terms with the fact that my career was pretty much gone, and I just lost this relationship, and I was back in Bendigo, and I was, you know, 130 kilos. And then there's all of this shameful behavior and all of the shit things that I did to Johnny and all the shit things that I did to the friends that I had and all of this other stuff that I'd collected that I'd just been shoving down and avoiding by using more and more and more.
Mm-hmm. And so how did we get from being in the family home, kind of being, I want to use the word rescued almost, from Sydney, I'm sure they probably saw it that way.
Yeah.
To things taking a very, very drastic turn.
Yeah,
in look, the next chapter.
It didn't happen overnight. And one of the things, you know, about my wonderful family and my brothers and sisters, and it, like, there were so many times everybody just rallied to get Kate back on board. And I think that if you talk to many families that have got a member of their family going through addiction, like, love drives it to begin with, you know what I mean? Like, they're there and they're like, let's just get Kate or whoever, you know, back on track, and they just need to get a job, or they just need, you know, a fresh start, or they just need whatever it is, and they'll be okay. And my family certainly did that a lot. And it was still early days for them really having any concept or understanding of what addiction truly meant. I didn't really know what addiction truly meant yet, you know what I mean? Yeah. So probably there was a lot of enabling from them during that time. And, you know, my dad, I came back and I got a job really easy. And, you know, my dad thought, I'll set her up in her own house and she'll have her own space and she'll feel like an adult and it'll make her feel good and all of that stuff that, yes, sounds like it would make it feel better, I guess. But, you know, all of these Band-Aids, I'll call them, still weren't dealing with that core issue. And then on top of that, like, the one thing that I hated the most and that I tried to be the whole time was at its absolute worst. Like, I was, you know, it sounds rough, but I was morbidly obese. Mm. You know, there's not many photos, but I've got the photos to show that.
What do you think it was about Bendigo that made it harder for you with your body insecurities and your weight fluctuation? Because you were saying that you gained quite a bit of weight while back in Bendigo.
Look, I was just on a gaining weight journey. Like, I think after the Divas finished and I was in that, you know, using and binging all the time, and obviously when you're binging and using a lot, certain drugs, when you stop, you haven't eaten in a while, so you're starving, so you just eat like crazy. And then other drugs that I was using were actually just making me super hungry all the time, so I was using and eating, and I was just literally grabbing at whatever I could.
Mm-hmm.
To make me feel better at this point. And yeah, when I got back to Bendigo, those drugs weren't there. So it really came down to food and then alcohol. You know, alcohol really hadn't been a part of my story up until I came back to Bendigo, because I couldn't get the things that I wanted. So, you know, two things that aren't good for the waistline is excessive drinking and binge eating.
Mm-hmm.
So it made it hard, but it you know, it came to a point where I remember I sat on the edge of my bed. I just had a shower and I was puffing.
Mm.
You know, I'm 26 maybe, and I was puffing. I was like, hey, your grandmother is fitter than you, and it's not okay. And I actually had to come to a point where I had to admit defeat and go, I don't have another crazy diet in me. I don't have another detox or another, you know, trip to Thailand to do a boot camp, you know, whatever it is. That, and I'd done so many things, you know, I should write a list one day, but I didn't have it in me, and I went to see my doctor, and it was sort of the end of the road, and I decided to have a gastric sleeve.
Yeah. And this is, we spoke about it in episode one, you had liposuction at 19 or 20.
Mm.
I'm sure there's, like you said, there's been so much since then leading up to this point, diets and all that kind of stuff. And now we're doing gastric sleeve, which is another massive operation, right?
In your body. Yeah, it's pretty final. Like, that shit don't grow back. You know, once they remove your stomach, it's a permanent thing. It's not like a band where they can take it out and you can have some kind of control over it. It's just your ability to eat food, with the one thing that I'd been doing since I was five.
Mm.
Yeah, you just can't eat food.
Once you have an operation, like, and as we say, if they take your stomach out,
I think it's roughly about, are they, so, you know, there's like a, you know, you imagine your stomach and there's a, like there's a pouch, and they essentially remove that pouch part. That's my medical technical description of that. Pouch part. Did you like that?
Yeah, checks out.
And they remove that and they leave you with a really small percentage of stomach.
Okay. Yeah. And I'm sure after you have that done, there's probably warnings around substances, I imagine.
Oh, there's warnings around lots of things. Like, don't eat is the first one. Yeah. And it was relatively new, I think, when I mean, it had been around for a while, but it wasn't as maybe common as it is now, gastric sleeves. And so the recovery was relatively slow. Like, I think waking up for the first 3 days, there was no, it was pretty much nil by mouth bar, like water and, you know, fine liquids. And if you break those rules, you can do like permanent damage to your stomach and be in hospital for a really long time. So, you know, it was a slow recovery. Going from eating pies and Mars bars every half an hour of a day to like eating puree and yogurt and only being able to have a few mouthfuls is it's quite confronting and quite shocking.
How long was that for?
It's been a while now, but I think the first 3 months back then was pretty intense. It was a slow, gradual reintroduction to eating food. So, yeah, it was purees and then sort of thicker mashes and stuff, and it was a while before I could eat solid food, yeah.
Mm. I'd imagine, given what you'd gone through and then you make this another massive step, okay, I want to get gastric sleeve, you got your doctor's helps, you obviously your surgeon's helps, your family around you. Did that feel at the time like you were turning a corner and here's the health and wellness now and we're going to get on the track of being a healthier version of yourself? Did that feel like a real like fork in the road?
Yeah, I mean, it did. It felt like, here we go, back to the solution. When I get thin, everything will be okay again. You know what I mean? But whilst that was happening, you know, and so once I'd had the operation, now I'm not able to eat anymore, I'm only really left with drinking, you know what I mean? And drinking, and I'm really not proud of some of the things I'm about to say, but like, I had a job as a receptionist, and I was, you know, I was drinking vodka in a Gatorade bottle for lunch and then driving shit-faced, you know, and doing really behaviors that I would never do, and in this, you know, in this body sitting here right now, like, I can't imagine that I did that. But you know, I was drinking really alcoholically, and I was waiting, you know, when I wasn't at work, I was waiting for Aldi to open, you know, buy $2 bottles of red wine. And so, yes, on one scale, there was that thing of me starting to look better, but that addiction side hadn't calmed. It hadn't calmed, and it was still, even because it wasn't in the form of nitrous, and it looked a little bit different, and sadly, alcohol is obviously socially acceptable, so you can kind of make that look okay for a little while, and you can't sit up with your parents and suck on nitrous and do cocaine, but you can certainly sit up there and drink red wine and look like you're fitting in and doing really well.
Yeah, because at the same time, you've got this, it's almost like, you know, oh, I've had this operation, I know I need to be healthier, I know I need to lose weight, my nan's fitter than I am, you know, you've got this massive thing in. But was it more about being skinny rather than being healthy?
Because
if it was to be healthy, I imagine you probably wouldn't have had, you know, I don't know. I mean, it's hard. Obviously, I can't relate because it's not my story.
For me, it's always been about being skinny.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? At any cost. And but I think for everybody else, it was look at her looking healthy. It was a different language. But for me, it was as shallow as skinny is best. You know, and skinny means we can get back to work and, all of that kind of stuff. As that happened, and yes, I started to lose weight, but my drinking really got out of control, and then I started to find where I could actually get nitrous in Bendigo, and I would go out and do that, and then my family started to catch me. And, you know, I have an incredible – I had a very close relationship with my brother and my sister. My sister and I's relationship has grown a lot more in our later years, and I out of respect from her, and one of my greatest shames, I did some pretty horrendous things. She came and lived in Sydney for a little while with me when I was some of at my worst, and she was a young, vulnerable 16-year-old girl who looked up to her sister, and I was just really shit person, and I didn't do what I should have done. But out of respect for her, I won't go. That's her story to tell, not mine.
Mm-hmm.
Bless her little heart. But so I had this incredible relationship with my brother in particular, and they started to see the unravel, you know what I mean? And they started to see that I was behaving weirdly and doing these behaviors and causing, and then of course because I was causing my mum and dad so much stress and pain, the relationship with my brother and already with my sister by that point really started to break down.
Yeah.
And the resentment from them and the hate and the anger, which really is just masked fear and pain and sadness, really started to show.
Yeah. And now you're back addicted to nitrous, I imagine, again.
Just using it because I found it, you know what I mean? And as I've said, like, I'm addicted to air at this point. By this point, whatever I can get my hands on that are going to give me that relief, even for a second, from all of that shit pain that I've committed and dedicated a good 10 years by now, like, we're looking at 10 years of, like, committed running and committed hiding and avoidance, like, just avoiding that big black hole that at this point I still don't even really know what it is, you know what I mean? I just know that since I was a kid, I've just known that there's this thing that I fucking hate and that I don't want to feel, and that it has grown bigger and bigger and scarier and worse, and I've gathered and collected more pain and more shit and more shame over this, what am I, 28 years, you know what I mean? And that's a heavy bag to carry by now. So it's not about, I don't think at this point, it's important to explain, like, it's, at this point it's not about the nitrous or the alcohol or the whatever. It's actually just about whatever I can latch onto.
And then you took a job up in Queensland, right?
Yeah. So by this point I've lost a lot of weight. I'm starting to look pretty good. And through a family friend, I get offered an opportunity, which again is like my 57th chance at a career, right? And by this point, my family are pretty aware and my manager are pretty aware that my mental health isn't good. But I get offered this job. The lady that did the breakfast show up there was going on maternity leave and they needed me someone to come and fill in, and they're like, Kate, you can come and do it. And I was like, yeah, I am. I'm coming. You know, that sounds wonderful. And everybody said to me for the first time, Kate, I don't think that that's a good idea. Like, I'm a grown woman by this point. Like, I'm not a kid. They can't tell me that I can't.
Mm. And you had a couple years out of the spotlight at this point, right?
Yeah, quite a few. So, like, a lot had happened. I'd really taken myself. Obviously, I'd been on that couple of years in Sydney where I just using took over and I'd mucked up a bunch of opportunities. And then, you know, I came back to Bendigo and I don't know, as I said, it's pretty blurry. I want to say maybe it was a year or two of being here and going through that operation, and no one had known where I was for a while. So it was like, okay, here's another shot. You're looking good.
Yeah.
Whatever. But the people that knew me the best knew that I wasn't in a good way and that was going to end in disaster. But I convinced them all that no, I was going to go and I was out to prove something. Yeah. Like, I guess the truth of that story is, and we'll go there now, is, had I listened, my life might look a bit different today. You know, I think that was the choice that I made and the point that I tried to prove that changed the course of my life and took me to places that I didn't know were, like, I'd been a drug addict and I'd done some pretty shitty things and I'd seen some pretty shitty things, but compared to where I was about to go and what I was about to do, it was pretty light, if that makes sense.
Yeah. It's in a bizarre way, it almost feels like up until this point, it's like it's manageable. It's not good. The nitrous and the, like, everything else is not good. But from our conversations, it's like this next step was like, this is when it, I don't know if you use the words rock bottom. Does this feel like this next phase is rock bottom for you, or is
Yeah, I feel like there'd be, I mean, rock bottom is a benchmark, right? And it moves and you think you hit a rock bottom and it's like, wow, that was bad for me and I can't imagine going any lower. But addiction, unfortunately, as it progresses, is that, and I think the benchmark always shifts and moves. And you start off doing things that seem pretty lighthearted and it seems like acceptable, and then you go, oh yeah, but I'd never do that because I've got this moral or this value or I don't believe in that, or, you know, and then it and then it progresses a little bit and you progress with it. Mm. And so you pick up the mark and you move it back over there. You go, well, I'm comfortable with this, but I would never do that. I kept moving that benchmark. And I guess it's like the friendships that you have in addiction. Like, you start off with the people that have a little bit of cocaine on the weekend and put the bag in the drawer half full, which I never understood. You know, that was my thinking, that was different. And then you outgrow that group, and so you find the next group that move a little bit and do a little bit harder, and then you outgrow them, and they look at you and be like, Kate, slow down. And so you dump them and so on and so forth till you find the people that use the way you do.
So
what happens from there is going to be really hard for me to talk about, and could maybe quite confronting for some people to listen to.
If you're ready to talk about the moment you're in the car.
I went to Maroochydore and I was doing this job, and my drinking was like, I'd never drank like that before. Like, I was drinking to blackout every day. And I know you know a little bit about, you know, what breakfast radio takes. And, you know, that alarm would go off at 3:30 in the morning and I would reek of booze, and I would, you know, I'd broken my leg 2 weeks before. I was meant to take this brand new job, and the idea was for me to go and part of the show was I was going to, explore Maroochydore on air, you know what I mean, as a tourist, and experience it and report back. And I turn up with a broken leg and a cast up to my knee and crutches, and they're like, well, that's a really great start. I would finish work, and I was meant to be there till like 12, and by 9:30 I'd be coming up with an excuse to leave, and I'd be hightailing it to the bottle shop and just buying bottles and bottles of wine and just drinking until I passed out. There was a lot of behaviours that I did during that time drunk that I am not proud of, and that I I'd be certainly devastated to know that my child had behaved or held themselves like that. I think Dave got a call, and it was not subtle. Like, I would have stank, you know. Mm. I don't know if you've ever sat next to somebody and the next day has had a big night, but that was me every day.
Yeah.
And this poor guy who didn't know me from a bar, so it was now like trying to just manage this show on his own, and this crazy alcoholic girl, and it was I owe him an amends. But
did anyone at the station say anything?
Yeah, they rang Dave.
Yeah.
A few times. Your manager. And Dave would come, you know, he would call and be like, what's going on? And my mum came and she tried to suss out what was going on, and you know, I just was a fucking mess, and I was just a classic drunk, and I'd never been that before, but I was in this town where I'd, you know, it was just easy and accessible, and that's just what I was doing. And at the end of that, essentially, I got fired, I think, and that's how it ended, which was, in radio's a really small, a small community, and it's, you know, word gets around pretty good. And look, and by that stage, my name was pretty much mud everywhere. You know what I mean? On a professional level, from, you know, I'd behaved, you know, through trying to carry all of that discomfort and shame and embarrassment about my body, and you know, I became hard to work with because I was always operating from this space of fear and just low level discomfort and shame. Which we'll talk about when I get to recovery, which I didn't understand it to be that then, obviously. But since I've done some work and I reflect on my life and my behaviours, when shame acts up in my life, I'm horrible. You know what I mean? When I'm operating from a place of shame, I get really defensive and angry and quite aggressive, which is just a byproduct of being sad. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Normally when people are sad and angry, it's normally from being sad and hurt. And unfortunately my name still remains pretty muddy around the place, and it's taken some work to start to undo that. You know, I'd done my time on Maroochydore, and I was, you know, my family, I think, were pretty excited to get me back in their grips and back in the safety of their arms. But I had a long a very long time friend of mine, my hair and makeup artist, and one of my best friends still to this day, had moved back to hang out with his parents and do a business venture in Airlie Beach. And I decided that I wanted to go and visit him before I went back to Bendigo. And I knew there was a part of me that knew once I got back to Bendigo, like it was up, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like time was up and things were going to have to get looked at. And I was in Airlie Beach and I was on, I met a person, I met a guy really randomly, and I ended up in this car with this guy, and he was like, I'm going for a drive to Mackay. I don't know why I thought Mackay was a quick 20 minutes down the road, but
it's like 2 hours,
it's quite a way. And I was like, yeah man, let's go. So I went with this person that I didn't know, and like, well, who does that? Yeah. You know what I mean? Who, like my just, I was just in risky behavior, like I just had no self, I just wasn't aware and I just didn't care, you know what I mean? My ability to care or think of dangerous behaviors and all of that stuff was just so far gone. Like I just didn't care, as long as I was distracted from my feelings and the way I felt. And in that particular moment it came in the form of this guy. And then halfway on this drive I realized that he was on drugs.
Right.
I hadn't seen drugs in a while.
And you didn't know until then that he was, that he was high.
No, but you know, if you know, you know.
Yeah.
And I knew, and I can't remember exactly what I said, but basically I said, I don't know what you have, but you need to give it to me and share it with me. And the next thing I know, he pulled out crystal meth, methamphetamines, ice, whatever you want to call it. It's got many names.
Yeah.
And that was it. I got high with him, and unlike other drugs that I'd had before, I went from never having this drug to having it every day from that day pretty much for the next 6 years.
6 years?
Thereabouts, I think, yeah. It would be, yeah, about 6 years every day user from that day on.
Mm.
But, yeah, look, ice... And it's a tricker. It's a real tricker, because in the beginning, like there was a part, like suddenly booze instantly went away. You know what I mean? Like yeah. It was gone. I stopped drinking. I didn't even think about alcohol. It was just this new thing that I'd found. And it was a level up in the sense of it was doing the job that cocaine had done all those years ago.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It gave me that relief. It gave me that freedom. And it solved some new issues for me. It made me not hungry.
Okay.
It took away the desire to eat food. It helped me lose weight quicker. And to be honest, in the beginning, it actually made me function better than I'd functioned in a really long time. You know what I mean? It made me feel like I was clearer. I wasn't drunk anymore. So suddenly my family were like, she sounds really great. And I had them fooled, and including myself, I guess, that I was on some kind of path to getting better.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Because the next time the public hears about Code de Rouge, it's headlines. And it's headlines around meth. It's headlines around weapons.
Yeah, look, there was a couple of times I ended up in the media for drug use. And, you know, to try and make a really long story as short as I can. So, you know, I was in Mackay. I spent some time in Mackay. This person that I was hanging out with loved going into the bush and doing all that sort of stuff. And my dad had known me as this country girl who loves going camping and spending time in the bush. And so he heard that I was out doing that stuff and I sounded clear. So there was a part of them was like, well, hang on, maybe she's found something.
Hmm.
You know, at least that's what they said to me. Whether they believed it or not and were trying to, I don't know. Like, I just remember my mum saying to me on the phone one time, said, you sound better than you've sounded in a really long time. But it was time for me to go home. So I'd convinced this person, again, I won't use their name because it's not about that, but that we should move back to Bendigo, you know. And so we packed up his car.
What was the reasoning behind wanting to come home? Because like you touched on the fact that it's harder to hide in Bendigo from your family, from the community, what's going on. So if you've, you know, you're in the depths of meth addiction,
yeah,
in Mackay, it's two states away from your hometown.
I think there was a deluded part of me that, and we'd spoken about it. I felt good, and I was stuck in this quite often. You know, part of when you're in addiction, there's lots of other addictions that come up, and one of the ones that has really played into, especially in that later years of my using, was love. They coupled together, but sex and love addiction. So, you know, I was in this intense new relationship with this person that I'd never felt before, and it was fueled by this, you know, ice-fueled relationship, which is a really hard one to explain. And I think that love addiction is something that I'd like to come back to further down in this podcast because it deserves a big conversation and it's really relatable. But yeah, I was in this bubble, and we'd had this conversation. We were like, you know what? Let's stop using. Mm. Let's stop using and go back to Bendigo. And I was talking to Dave about my manager again, and I think the plan was to go back to Bendigo and look at getting back into some kind of work. So we set off on this drive from Mackay back to Bendigo, and as all. You know, it's that insanity. We're like, we'll just get this last bag. You know what I mean? We'll just get this last big bag to get us home to Bendigo. And then when we get there, we'll stop.
Mm.
And I believed that. And I, you know, I told myself that story so many times over the years that we'll just have this last hurrah. And then when we get there, we'll stop. And I think I truly believed that. I don't know why. Like it's not like I'd ever been able to do it before, but yeah, in that moment I really believed that when we got there we'd stop.
In Bendigo you're surrounded by a beautiful family and friends who love you and want the best for you.
Hmm.
And I think there'll be a lot of people listening to this podcast who have a friend or a family member that has addiction, that struggles with addiction.
Yep.
And I just wonder if you have any kind of insight into anything that could have been done or said or handled, like what your advice would be for someone who
from a family perspective.
Yeah
And again, like I feel like this is such a big conversation, like this story, although it may sound shocking to some, like it's not an uncommon story, and my story is actually in the world of addiction, and there is so much of it out there, like it's not unique or special or more, it's just a really common story, you know what I mean? And even though the details might look a little bit different, what's going on inside is normally exactly the same. But as far as a family is concerned, again, which I feel like I want to talk about this further down the track on a much bigger level, because and I think one of my family members, you know, would love to share their experience too. But and it's just from not understanding addiction, and my family loved me so much. Mm. And as much as this sounds terrible, but they loved me in the wrong way, especially in those later years. Like they didn't understand how to love me the way, not the way that I wanted them to, in the way that I needed them to.
Right.
And I think the real changing moment for not just me, but just as importantly them, you know, it's not just a me disease, it's a family disease, and it affects the onlookers just as deeply, if not more so, because they're not the ones making the choices I am, or the addict is, you know what I mean? So for them and for me, it was a real changer, which we'll get to, when they went out and got themselves educated.
Mm.
You know, there's which I'll link at the end somewhere here for people to click on, but there's actually a lot of services and avenues that maybe people don't know about where they can get educated and have an understanding of addiction and what it is and how to help from an outsider.
We'll put that in the show notes. Yeah. So if you're listening now, there'll be a link there.
Super important stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, look, when we came back to Bendigo, I think my family just saw me. I was looking good. I sounded good. I wasn't drunk all the time anymore. You know, again, I'd lost a lot more weight, and that equaled health at the time. And we all know now that skinny doesn't equal health. It just equals skinny.
Mm. Were they asking you if you were on anything?
No, because I'd had a gastric sleeve, right? So it all made sense. It was like, yeah, well, she's had this stomach operation, so of course she's losing weight. And I was like, yeah, it's just the stomach. But, you know, as soon as we got back to Bendigo and that bag finished, all of those, those feelings were there. They hadn't gone, you know what I mean? They weren't going to go. And they were there again with a bigger, and now I had collected a whole new bunch of things that I felt shit about, like all my behaviors that I'd done and all of that, behaviors that I'd done in Maroochydore that I wasn't proud of, that went totally against all those morals and values that I thought I had. And that benchmark had really moved by now. I've dumped one backpack and filled up 10 more by now, and I'm carrying all this around. And so the bag finished, and that anxiety and that absolute powerlessness, obsession and compulsion to need something to run away from myself was back, and it was bigger and it was louder than ever.
Mm.
So naturally, I went and found it. But this time I'd met this drug named ice, and nothing else was going to cut the mustard anymore. Mm. Nitrous wasn't going to do it. Food, alcohol, nothing was doing it. And I was hooked on this drug, and in a way that I'd never really felt hooked on anything before. I know that maybe doesn't make sense, but it was a different kind. It was a different kind of need. It felt, and the come down and the detox from it literally felt like death. To the bit where I'm in the media, everybody thought I was doing pretty well. So I rang Dave and I said, I'm ready. You know, I look good. People, you know, I feel good. I've got this music that we've recorded. I think it's time to release it. And he was like, okay. And I remember he said to me, I'll do this, but you don't lie to me and no drugs. And I was like, no worries. Mm. Whilst I was using flat out, you know what I mean? And I just was living this lie. And
there was still a desire for you to be doing music, right?
Yeah, like that desire, it's never left me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, it did in parts, and I don't know, you know, whether it was just because I wanted to prove to people that I was okay, that I wanted to do it. And I think that's what this last bit was. I think I knew deep down that I was not capable of, you know, showing up and being the artist and what it takes to be an artist. You know, it takes commitment, and it's not just all about, red carpets and all the glamorous shit. Like it's hard work, and it takes a lot of commitment and hours and unpaid hours. And I knew I didn't have that in me deep down, but I was still out trying to prove to everybody that I was okay. And so my very last, and this was the actual last rally that I did to pull my shit together, to be that Kate DeRouche that everybody thought that I could be and that I so desperately wanted to be. I had this song called Shut Your Mouth, and I was really proud of it. And my mum and I, I had a conversation with this person, and I said, I'm going to go and give this world a crack now, and I need your support. So he stayed at home and I went off to Sydney. And, I drove all the way with my mum, and we were off to do this film clip, and it was all big stuff. It was all, you know, the film clip and the photo shoots, and you know, I could show you some of those photos, and I look unbelievable, but I was the sickest I've ever been. Like, yeah. I'd never been so sick. And when I got there, I dropped my mum off at the airport the next day, and I went driving around Sydney. It had been Mardi Gras, and I just, you know, without even thinking, went for a drive and was like, let me have a look at whatever's going on around the streets. And I ran into a booze bus.
Mm.
And I was like, sweet, I'm not drunk, no worries. And it was early in the days of drug testing. I went through the booze bus, and it passed the booze part. And
you thought it was just for alcohol at this
point. I'd never even really heard, I don't think, about drug testing.
Yeah.
You know, I probably wasn't one to watch the news a lot at that point, but and then he said, if you just pull over here, we're just doing random drug testing. And I was like, what? And that was it, positive for methamphetamines. And
did you know going into that test, you're like, there's no way I'm clean?
No, like I had drugs in the car with me. Yeah. You know what I mean? They were hidden in the back seat.
Yeah.
I'd never stopped using. It had been, I don't even know how long it had been since I'd gone a day without it. And if I had gone a day without it, it had been not a good day, and I'd spent the day trying to find a way to get it.
And then the court case?
Yeah, so the court case was coming. And look, so that all happened. And the first one was, you know, Kate DeRouche, choose ice or whatever. And again, like the insanity of all of that is my biggest concern of that whole sentence was that I chewed ice, you know. And it was, I was just so far gone, and I have, and looking back, like I really thought I had it all together, and I was just so unwell and so deluded. And yeah, look, again, I could tell you a bunch of stories that happened through that time. But I guess when I got to the court date and it was busted open, and obviously all the work that Dave had done through that time, you know, in one headline was gone. Long story short, I did a lot of using, and I found myself in Shepparton and in a halfway house, you know, basically begging for drugs. I had no money. I had no access to money. I would call my mum randomly every couple of weeks, just hysterically asking her to come and get me. But then when she did try and come and get me and ask where I was, I'd panic and be like, I don't want to stop using. Don't come near me. And it was, you know, I was just in this place of just, I was basically in a shooting gallery, just waiting for somebody to feed me some scraps of drugs so I could get through another day. And then I met,
we can call him.
Okay. We'll call him. They say it can always get worse. Like the ultimate rock bottom is death, right? That was heavy, but it is. And was a person that I never thought that I would allow in my world. But I guess, you know, no one ever thinks that domestic violence or abuse or any of that stuff is something that they would allow in their world. And it certainly doesn't start like that on the first date. You know what I mean? And, you know, I was in a pretty, I was in the most vulnerable place I'd ever been. Like I had nothing. I had no one. I had no friends, my family. I desperately wanted to be near them, but I didn't want to stop what I wasn't ready to stop what I was doing because I wasn't ready to face all of those things. And then there was this guy, and he sounds ridiculous, but he saved me in a way, you know what I mean? He saved me from that house, and he saved me from that place, and he gave me what I needed in that moment, which was drugs, and he made me feel safe, and he made me feel acceptable, and he made me feel not like a dirty, like he made me feel normal, you know what I mean, in this totally outrageous normal world that I was now living in, that I didn't belong in. Like, who is this idol singing, diva dancing girl from Bendigo doing in this halfway house in fucking Shepparton, like begging for drugs? Like, you know.
It's a far cry from that photo from the grand finale.
Yeah, it's yeah, and you know what, and just to step sideways again for a second, like addiction, that's addiction, you know what I mean? Doesn't give a shit, doesn't care who you are, where you came from, or what TV show you were on, or how much money your parents have, or how much they didn't have, or what school, like it doesn't care. If it gets you, like you'll end up in a halfway house in Shepparton, you know what I mean? It might look different for everybody else, but if it gets in, it's in.
And I think it's like, I mean, I even asked you, you know, last episode, I'm like, did something happen in your childhood? Like, was there a traumatic event? Or like, but actually that's why your story is so powerful, because you did come from a loving home. You have a beautiful family. You got great friends. You're from a beautiful hometown. And it just shows you that, you know, if it can happen to
anyone,
this beautiful winner of Australian Idol who's up in lights and
can happen to anyone,
idolized and worshipped, you know?
Anybody in the right setting, with the right, you know, self-hatred and loathing and carrying, you know, anybody can end up in their own halfway house in Shepparton with a, I mean, anybody can. He taught me a new way to use, and a way to use that I never thought that I would use, and that was the final benchmark mover for me. He taught me and showed me his way of life, and you know, I he'd been in that world for a lot longer than I had, and he didn't have a family that would pull him out of shit like I did, and he found his own way to survive, you know what I mean? And he was an opportunist, and he did what he needed to do, and he had his own set of traumas and his own set of things that he was running from. Mm. You know what I mean? And I but yeah, he filled that, and for the first time in years, I had felt that sense of being normal and being accepted and not and being loved, and I felt lovable, and he had this way of making me feel good in a way that no other man or person had. No, I'll call it for what it is. No other man had ever been able to make me feel. I didn't feel insecure. I felt good about myself. And it was my first true experience with love addiction. And I needed this man, and I needed this love, and I needed this feeling that he gave me every bit as much as I needed to use a drug. And it gave me that same kick, and it gave me that same high, and it was almost a bigger solution at this point than the drugs themselves. Mm. But put together, you know, it was the most toxic space that I, you know, had ever been in. And no one could get me out. No one could tell me any different. And I was warned by many girls before me, and I was warned by people around, like, he's a dangerous human and he will hurt you. And I was deluded, and I was like, no, I'm different. He'll treat me different. He loves me different. He would never do that to me, until the day he did. You know what I mean? And, you know, there was a lot of abuse through that relationship. There was a lot of mental abuse. There was physical abuse, you know. There was I got, you know, stabbed in one of his rages, in one of his own ice, angry, raging events. You know, I ended up with a machete in my leg and in a hospital lying about it, you know. And
what did you say when they asked you?
I said I fell on a bit of tin on a job site, and they just looked at me like, whatever, like, you know, you know, fell down the stairs type story. Yeah. But, you know, and I guess it's just, you know, I was at the end of the road and I had nothing left, and I'd really lent into the idea that this was my life, and that I was never going to get out, and using drugs every day was just what I was going to have to do, and it was just where my life was going to end, and that was it for me. And this person helped me do that, you know what I mean? And we were a team, and we were an inseparable team. But yeah, I guess just like drugs, my addiction with him, like I would chase and strive that release that he gave me, and it became less and less and less, and until I was done, you know what I mean? And I feel like this is a topic and something I'd like to talk about. I feel like it deserves a bigger conversation than just, but I, you know, I'm conscious that people don't have all day. I feel like it's a conversation that I want to have further, but you know, he and that situation, you know, eventually he went to jail, and he went to jail twice during our time, but the second time he went to jail, I wasn't expecting it. And we just went to court one day, and we both thought that he'd walk out on bail, and they took him away then and there on that day. And I'd never felt panic, you know what I mean? I'd never felt panic like I felt that day. I'd lost this this love of my life that I thought that I needed to breathe, and I literally, like, I needed him to breathe. Mm. And I it's a hard thing to explain. He was gone, and I wasn't going to see him again for I didn't know how long. And also, he was my supply. He was my partner in crime. He helped me get onto the drugs that I needed every day to use. And by that point, like, I was on a $500-$600 a day habit at a minimum. You know what I mean? Centrelink check isn't getting you past day one. Yeah. So from there, like, that was the real downward spiral that I never thought that I would find myself on. You know, I started doing whatever it is that I needed to do, and I don't feel the need to go into too many details about that because, you know, there's people and I have a little son and there's some things that people just don't need to know. But I guess, yeah, I did everything and anything that I could do within my power to get what I needed to use, and I had lost all self-respect and self-love. My morals and values were gone. You know, I'd put all that away and I had no intentions. Like that story I would tell myself over nighttime of the next day, I wasn't going to do it, like that would have gone. That was no longer a thing. I would just go, well, what am I going to do tomorrow to use?
Yeah.
Until I found myself, and I don't know what it was, whether it was a higher power or something greater than me or why, but there was just one day that I caught a look at myself in the mirror and I had a bruised face, and I couldn't use the way I needed to use, and I just looked at myself and I was like, fuck, what's, like, who the fuck are you? Like, who is this person? And I just knew in that moment, if things didn't change, like right now, I was going to die. It wasn't going to be long. I just had this feeling inside of me, and I rang my mum and I said, and she was about the only one. Oh, she was about the only one left that would still even give me the time of day. My brother and sister were so angry and just done and didn't believe a word I had to say. And who would? I didn't believe a word I had to say. Why were they going to? And my dad was done, and my mum was the only one that would, she just came, and I just said, Mum, I need help, and I need it. And that was it. I packed up what was left, like everything else, like everything of any value had been pawned or hocked or stolen or sold or lot or whatever. I packed up what I thought was important and put it at my parents' place, and I walked out of my house, and I've never been back to that house ever since. You know, somebody else dealt with that I never could walk back in there, but yeah, that was it. And I'd like to say that was the last day I used. It wasn't. It was a couple of weeks. There was about a month after that I finally I went to a rehab in Melbourne. I knew that change had to happen, but I just wasn't quite ready. I hadn't really got my head around the fact that when I made that choice, like, it was time, you know. Yeah. What I mean? And it was time to stop, and I was going to have to put down the drugs, and I was going to have to put down the relationship, and I was going to have to put down everything, and I was going to have to stop, turn around and face the 12 years of just shit show and life and pain and fear and self-hate and mistakes that I'd made. Plus, you know, all that childhood stuff that I'd had, and it was time. And I, it was time.
And then you started your recovery.
Yeah, and that's a whole other chapter and just as big of a story as the addiction, you know what I mean? And I guess that's it. Like, that's my story up until the end of my addiction, and you know, as I said, I'd like to say that's the last time I used. I did use a few more times after that, but the process and the knowing of recovery was there, and I knew that spiritual death had happened and that I needed to change. But yeah, I guess the next bit, and we'll talk about that next week, but if this story's triggered something in anybody, like, keep listening, because there is always hope. And if I can come back from where we did and where I did, then anybody can.
Yeah. I'm excited to go through the recovery and just hear about how you got to where you are now today. You know, you're in Bendigo, you got a beautiful life, beautiful son, beautiful partner.
It's hard to believe, like, 5.5 years sounds long, but in the big scheme of things, it's pretty unbelievable to see how in 5.5 years how much can change.
On a dark desert highway, cool wind in my hair, warm smell of calites rising up through the air. Up ahead in the distance, I saw a shimmering light. Head grew heavy and my sights grew dim. I had to stop for the night. There she stood in the doorway, heard the mission bells. I started thinking to myself, this could be heaven or this could be hell. Then she lit up a candle and she showed me the way. Heard some voices down a corridor, thought I heard them say, welcome to the Hotel California, such a lovely place, such a lovely face. There's plenty of room at the Hotel California, any time of year you can find us here. Mine is Tiffany Twisted, she's got the Mercedes Benz. She's got a lot of pretty, pretty boys that she calls friends. As they dance in the courtyard, sweet summer sweat. Some dance to remember, well, some dance to forget. So I called up the captain, said, please bring me my wine. But he said, we haven't had that spirit here since 1969. And still those voices are calling from far away. Wake you up in the middle of the night just to hear them say, welcome to the Hotel. Such a lovely place, such a lovely face. We're living it up at the Hotel California. Such a nice surprise. Bring your alibis. Mirrors on the ceiling, pink champagne on ice. And she says, we're all just prisoners here of our own device. In the master's chambers as they gather for their feast, stab it with their steely knives, but they just can't kill the beast. Last thing I remember, I was running for the door. I had to find the passage back to the place I was before. Relax, said the nightmare, we are programmed to receive. You can check out anytime you like, but you can never leave.